Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
This time I want to call the meeting to order, and I'm going to call on Mr. Boswell for the invocation.
I would like to have David Carter with Baptist Temple come and say our invocation, please.
Thank you for giving me this privilege, Commissioner, and I want to wish all of you a Merry Christmas.
Thank you, David.
May we pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for the opportunity that we gather here tonight, for the concerned citizens and the elected officials who are here and those that serve in our county and cities. And we just thank you that we have the privilege and the freedom to be here and to discuss matters that are of great concern to this community. We ask that you grant us much wisdom. As we gather here and we practice these freedoms, we remember 68 years ago on this day, those who lost their lives at Pearl Harbor. And the sacrifices they made there, not just for those brave men and women, but for all who have given their lives in the defense of our freedom from that day to this day. We thank you for that. We thank you for the true meaning of Christmas, the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ. We ask that you be with us tonight, that you guide our steps. Thank you for all that you've done for us, and we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Next on our agenda is the old business, County Manager.
Thank you, Madam Chair. We have on your for the agenda approval of the minutes for the November 9th and November 16th meeting. Is there a motion on the floor?
I'll make the motion.
Motion.
Is there a second?
Second.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Very good. Thank you.
Next is the new business, election of chairman and vice chairman, Mr. Clyde Albright.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I'll call the organizational meeting to order and declare a quorum present. And call for nominations for chair. Point of order, can you nominate two at one time, or does it have to be one office, one seat, and then the vice chair?
If you'd like to take both nominations, one for vice chair, one for chair, I think it'd be in order.
All at one time.
Generally, it's done one right. Seat at a time.
I'd like to make that motion for two. One, if that's allowable. I've had probably the worst weekend of my life over this issue. I've been on our board now for 15 years, and we've never had an election that was we've never had one where it was contested to a big degree. I think each election's always been one where we've understood how it came about. Even the last one, when Democrats won the majority, had the majority, and we elected a Democrat chair. I don't think there were very many questions about that. I have talked to everybody today, but Ann, I've left a message with Ann and left a message with Bill, but I have talked to Eddie and Linda, and I've taken pride over the years that this board has, not maybe as a result of anything I've done, but I've definitely could have made it worse, I suppose. I've taken pride that this board has never really had a lot of hostility. Guilford County is, I've always thought, I hope this board never becomes a board like Guilford County's, where they literally almost fight out in the hall, throw water on each other. It's really an embarrassment to Guilford County. With all that said, it's been heavy on my heart all weekend, and I didn't plan for it to turn out this way. What I've meant at that time. I've had to reevaluate quite a few of my thoughts, and I'm happy right where I'm at in this seat. I think some people are geared better to be chair. Some other people may be geared to be vice chair, so forth and so on. With all that said, I know I'm rambling. I want to see us go a step beyond partisanship, a step beyond philosophy, a step beyond how we are as personalities. We all talk different. We all express ourselves differently. I think some of us are more passionate than others, and that's not a bad thing either, or even a good thing. It's just the way we are. I want us to get past that point. And I felt like this weekend that if I didn't nominate or didn't vote for the nomination of our current chair, Linda Massey, that I would be taking part in the philosophy that creates division rather than creates healing. Not that there's anything that's got to be healed, as much as I think I need to be a better communicator, and I think we all could be. And I would just like to say I want to, it will ease my, the burden on me if we can go on down the road. And I'm going to use the golden rule here and just say, do unto others as you would have them do unto you. And I want to nominate Linda Massey for chair and Eddie Boswell for vice chair.
And I'll second that.
And with all that said, it was kind of apropos that when I was trying to get in touch with Linda today, that she's getting ready to go represent the county at a function. And I thought, you know, that was kind of proof in the pudding for me that we just probably need to continue it as is. So I hope all these past comments can just be for the record. But for the record, I want to say let's move forward. And
thank you.
I think it takes a big person to say what Commissioner Sutton has just said. It's been a mess on the radio and in the newspapers and so forth, and to come back and do this. And I'll be honest with you, Mr. Sutton, I was going to do the same thing. you indicated to me this is what you want to do, and I think that's a great step. I'm proud of you.
We got a great board, and we've got a great county. And we just need to keep doing what we're doing and let the best vote, let the vote win, the majority win. And it doesn't matter whether you're Republican or Democrat, we got to do what's right for Alamance County. And I think Linda Massey has shown she's got more time than I'll ever have to represent the county as chair. And I don't know about Eddie, but I couldn't have ever done it.
I want to say Linda's done a great job over the past year, and she stepped in a tough time. We had a lot of things going on, and she's done a real good job in trying to manage that. And I just appreciate everything she's done, and I appreciate y'all's confidence in me to serve again as vice chair.
Well, I'm thank you so much. I have enjoyed serving as chair, and we hadn't voted yet, so have not made the vote yet. But I appreciate the nomination from Mr. Sutton, and he and I did talk today, and I hope we can move forward as well and have a great board, because we do have a great board. And I am proud to serve the citizens of Alamance County, and I love what I'm doing. I love meeting people and talking with people, because I like to talk. And it's just a great county that we have here, and I hope we can just continue to be a great county, because that's what I want it to be.
Any further nominations for chair or vice chair?
I move nominations be closed.
Second.
Nominations are closed. We'll take a vote on the motion for Ms. Massey for chair and Eddie Boswell for vice chair. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
All opposed? Congratulations, Madam Chair. And
thank
vice chair.
Thank you.
We'll now adjourn.
I didn't want
to
cry either.
We'll adjourn our organizational meeting at this time.
I'm a little nervous and shaky, but I got some sour mints up here. Okay, we will move on then. Thank you so much. Thank you. For the approval of bonds for public officials. We do have those right here. Mr. Pendergast?
These, as part of our organizational meeting, these have to be renewed on an annual basis. So these are for your approval.
Does anybody have any questions on that for those $50,000 bonds? Any questions? If not, I'll entertain a motion that we accept the review of the bonds of public officials.
Make a motion we accept those.
We have a motion.
Second.
A second. All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Okay, the next thing we have is public comments, and the first one is Mr. Ken Walker of our planning board. How are you, Mr. Walker?
Good evening.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, sir.
Good evening, Commissioners. I'm representing, I'll introduce myself. I'm Ken Walker. I'm with REMAX Diamond Realty. I come representing Mill Creek Development Company. I'm one of their real estate agents. They've asked me to come before the board tonight regarding the Alamance Orange County line issue. In your packet that I provided, you have several letters, one from Mill Creek, the president, Jeff Stallings. And I'd just like to read a couple paragraphs just for the record. He says, "We strongly support option 2V3 of the Orange-Alamance County boundary, which brings all of Mill Creek community, both developed and undeveloped, and current and future residents into Alamance County." He says, "As we previously expressed our belief that neighborhoods need to be whole and not divided, whole undivided neighborhoods promote better social relationships, childhood bonds, children of the neighborhood all go to the same schools, legislative representation for the residents of a neighborhood is more cohesive and fair, and finally, in these tight budget times, efficiency is important, and we strongly believe that the general and emergency services provided by the county would be provided more efficiently by Alamance County, and Alamance County would increase its tax base accordingly. Also, we recognize that there is a cost to making this change in the Orange-Alamance County boundary, and we understand that the homeowners and landowners will be required to fund new surveys. We are committed to this change and will accept this responsibility. We've already discussed this with our surveyor, and he is prepared to get to work on this project." In this packet, I've also included, there's been two proposals done for this additional work, one from R.S. Jones and Associates, and also another one, that one's at $17,800. And then the surveyors that did Mill Creek originally, Johnny Edwards with John A. Edwards and Company, their proposal was $11,500. And that would be to survey all of Mill Creek and bring it in accordance with the line that's being proposed. There's also a letter several other people have asked me to bring before you tonight. One is with the Stokes Land Group. These folks are the primary developer for the Arrowhead project in Mebane. They again have requested that they be taken totally in Alamance County, and I'll state that their cost of survey was $1,650, which they're fully prepared to fund as well. And then the final letter in your pack is a letter from Tanger Outlets. They're also requesting that their entire project would be in Alamance County. They've had their plats looked at and determined it would be around $2,000 for that survey work to be done, and they're fully prepared to pay that as well. Okay. So I think the emphasis is that these folks that are affected would certainly be like to be part of Alamance County in its entirety and are willing to pay for that action.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. I did forget to remind him that it's 3 minutes. So. But and thank you for that presentation, Dave. Next issue.
You just said that 3 minutes.
I know. I'm going to watch that clock.
Congratulations.
Thank you so much. I appreciate all
I
you said.
I gave y'all a packet. My phone number, my email's in it. You will see a cut of the old tape map that was used. Mr. Chill was back there at court, and a 1938 photo that basically shows the same road. And this is leading up to this page with the chimneys of Mason Hall. One of the points mentioned in the deed. You have my signature and two other people. These two people happen to live in that house. They know it was Mason Hall. And the gentleman was 82 years old. And that carries us on down this line you see on the front. I'm sure a deed research could be done back. I don't see why I have to do that. But you could research that deed back and prove it. The next one comes from 1878. This is the division of Hugh Wilson's property after he died. Hugh Wilson, the property is mentioned in the thing at 100 yards west of the house. That's getting close, 100 yards.
Of course, that one at you.
This. Two pages here's the division. My phone number's on the top of it. This is a plat I had drawn partially of that division. It's not the whole thing. The reason I did that, because the railroad tracks is up here. They hadn't moved the whole lot. And there's a fork in the branch down here that's mentioned in it. Shooting this angle to the branch, which shooting that angle back to the barn, would show you basically, because it says in here, the barns east of the house, would show you about where the house sat. And it would rebuke just 9 miles and 44 yards by everything that I can make.
Where is that?
This is right, well, actually the house has been buried under the interstate now, or right close to it, but it's where it is on the line where the state located 9 miles and 44 yards. And I feel like if you'd actually run this survey, you would find out that their 9 miles and 44 yards is about half a mile further up the road. I just got this one today and hadn't been able to do a lot of work on it. But I did remember the house, and I knew Sam Jr. This is the Colonel Paisley Nelson property. All right. Colonel Paisley was Sam's daddy's brother. Colonel Paisley died at Sam's house. Anyway, apparently Civil War broke out, and some of this stuff didn't get done until the 70s, because Colonel Paisley died in 1855. But I can show you enough of this that you could map this one out. And it gives you a line that is a whole lot straighter than what the state doing with their modern equipment. I don't know how them guys ran this straight line, but like I told him earlier, something apparently did go wrong down south, because I cannot make Bethlehem Church work into this no way. No how. I think somebody ought to go to the state archives and look at this original document that came from and see the handwriting, because you'll notice all this pretty calligraphy type handwriting. It's bound to be that somebody mistook a W for west or east or something. Somebody needs to research this stuff. I can only do so much. And finally, copy of the email from the state. In it, you will notice they admit with their modern equipment that they took you 9 miles and 44 yards with this satellite mapping stuff and stuck 165 feet on it. I wouldn't be standing here if they had kept that 165 feet. It would have never occurred to me to work for this. So that I want you to take this into consideration. If I would be happy with the option plan, but I think y'all ought to research this for Alamance County, because you're talking about a good half mile for the length of the county. And that's Alamance County. That's a lot of land for a bunch of years, we hope.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, next is Dan Tolfrey. That's Dan.
Dan. Irish, you call me something different. But anyway, I don't have five of these, or six songs to me. That's a map, and this is a picture of it. The map is a picture of permitted sludge areas in Alamance County. And I'm here to ask you as a board, and the only people that could do this, to designate Cane Creek in southern Alamance County as a protected or critical watershed. Right now it is the area of location where Synagro and Burlington Wastewater wants to dump their sludge, as you can tell by the map that this man has. The other picture is a map of sludge being put on a field adjacent to my property in February of this year, and all Diener will say is they put too many polymers in it. That's a Burlington Wastewater. I'm asking you to look at Cane Creek as a very valuable piece of property in this county. It goes across the whole southern part of this county. It's extremely rural still. And I'm afraid if it's continued to be the sludge site of choice, you may end up with lawsuits down the line from all the municipalities that pull water out of Jordan Lake. Because this Cane Creek flows right into the Haw River, flows into Jordan Lake. And I don't know if that will happen, but I would love to see that creek stay as rural and as alive as possible instead of being the wastewater treatment sludge fields that it is. I mean, you can see by that map, predominantly that's where Burlington's wastewater sludge goes. And that's basically all I'm here for, is you to take that into consideration. You have the ability to make it a watershed, which it is not now, because it does not provide any drinking water per se for Alamance County. Though if you go back 50 years, you'll see that in the plans it, they were going to dam up that creek for Burlington Water. Anyway, that's a history. Okay. I live along it, and I've watched it become more polluted as 30 years that I've lived along it goes on, from algae counts going up, insect going down, and just having rural Alamance County smell like a waste treatment plant for 2 weeks out of every year. And it's, that's all I ask, so you take it into consideration. So,
how does that land perk down there? Does it?
Well, see, that's the point. Cinegro, Burlington Wastewater love it because it perks very well. It's a very nice Georgian red clay soil that you can put stuff on it over and over and over. I've run the same septic system for 30 years, and I've only cleaned it out once because the soil perks so well. And that's what they love it for. Their testing goes through and tests it and says it fits all the numbers that DENR is supposed to, that they're supposed to go by. And that's the thing, it fits all the numbers, so there's no hue and cry about what it is doing. I have watched 50-foot buffers totally wiped out in a rainstorm, where I've seen water run across this sludge field in that picture directly into Cane Creek, over a 150-foot buffer. I mean, I watched it. I just think it's something that you people need to consider. DENR doesn't do a whole lot because everybody plays by the numbers, and the first step may be to make it a watershed like north of town, where you can see there's very few sludge sites up in Burlington's watershed. that's what I'm here to ask for, or for you guys to consider.
Okay. And I truly don't know how we could make it a watershed. We would have to Mr.
Yeah. All right. Actually, Jason.
Jason Martin. Yeah.
Planning.
Our plan. Yeah. So, but we can have them look at it and.
Well, thank you.
See what they think.
I appreciate
okay.
it.
Okay.
Thanks very much.
Thank you, Mr. Coffey. Next is Christopher Vaughn. Hey, how are you?
Evening. Thank you for taking the time to speak tonight. I'm here to present some information about those who are opposed to the Mill Creek subdivision change. I personally live in Mill Creek and am not in support of the county line change. The representative that spoke tonight specifically spoke about childhood bonds. I have three children, and they have great friends, and many of them live in Alamance County. Many live in Orange County. But regardless of the county they live in, they still have close bonds. And the second item that I wanted to specifically address was the emergency services being a difficult item for Orange County residents. All our emergency services come from Mebane City. We pay Mebane City taxes. And in fact, about a week and a half ago, there were fire and police called to an Orange County residence that responded from Mebane City. And I believe that specifically addresses one of your questions right. from last time. My second item was to talk about a petition of individuals that are also opposed to the Mill Creek subdivision change. I know that others have presented the idea that there is support for moving the county line, and it's vitally important that you guys understand that I'm not the only voice representing keeping the line as it is currently. There are others with me that would like to see the county line remain unchanged as it has been for the last 160 years, and I'd like to enter the petition into the record, if I may. Third, I'd like to address the injustice of the line change. Currently, I'm a taxpayer in a legal location in Orange County trying to preserve my location. The way I see this gerrymandering is by a special interest group trying to change the law that defines our counties to benefit this special interest group. I know that at least one of you guys ran on a platform of changing the county line, but I sincerely hope that the special interests will not outweigh the rights of legal taxpayers and voters. And lastly, I would like to ask each and every one of you to think hard about how this affects both residents of the near county line areas and Alamance County itself. Changing this line from that which has been in place for 160 years benefits a few and can hurt a great many. I urge you to adopt option one, the 1849 line found by the NCGS, because it's the most cost-effective, and we all know nobody really has any extra money right now. And in addition, option one is also the most legally fair and by far the most expeditious of the options. Option one puts to bed any further debate and makes this issue go away for good. Thank you for your time.
Thank you.
How many people do you have on your petition there?
16.
Do they all live in Mill Creek?
They do not all live in
Mill Creek. Oh, okay. I'm sorry.
Yeah. They're from places in Alamance and Orange Counties both.
Okay. Okay.
Thanks, sir. Get this. This is here. Okay. The next person is Ann Robbins. Hey, Sam. How are you?
Congratulations. Thank you. My name's Ann Robbins, and I live at 312 North 9th Street in Mebane. At the meeting of November the 9th at ACC, there was a consensus reached between Alamance-Orange boundary line dispute. At that time, I presented all involved with two presentations for their consideration signed by North 9th Street area residents. Tonight, I have a proposal from R.S. Jones Associates Incorporated, a local Mebane land surveyor, to survey our property for $2.30 per linear foot. We are ready to open an escrow account at SunTrust Bank in Mebane with our money when you're ready to vote for option 2V3. We feel that we are doing our part. Now do yours. The maps are already drawn. The surveyor has checked it out the area, and we're waiting on your yes vote. May I remind you that the Orange-Chatham line was changed in 2004 by moving the line. Other counties have done the same thing. May I also remind you that you have been using our tax dollars for 31 years. Orange County is more willing to make this happen there than our own county, whose salaries we pay and who voted you in as our commissioners. And I do have a copy of the proposal I'd like to give you. Also, I have done some research, not a lot, but it was about the North Carolina post offices from 1985 to 1882, and we're talking about Mason Hall. And that was a post office there, and it was original county was Orange County. The final county was Alamance County. The first U.S. postmaster was James Mason. The date started was April the 4th, 1809, and the day discontinued was February the 2nd, 1856. The gentleman that owns the Mason Hall now, he lives in Virginia. I did check on that. And some of the information that Eddie Hsu gave you, I got the book, the original book, from the same 80-some-year-old gentleman that he was talking about. And in it, it says, among other things, Mason Hall was one of the historic places in the early Hall Fields community. It had been built by Alexander Mebane and was located about 2 miles northeast of Mebane at the site of the dam that furnishes the water supply for the town. In E.B. Curry's time, it was the center of a number of activities, including a post office, a store, and stables where the stagecoach changed horses. And some of you remember, some of my people that are in this area do live on Stagecoach Road. When the railroad was built, the activities around Mason Hall shifted to the village that grew into Mebanesville, and when the dam was built, all of the old buildings were cleared away. So there's a lot more research that needs to be done out there. It looks like that the line is where the new map has been drawn, and I would like to present with you now the proposal from our surveyor.
Okay. Thank you, Ms. Robinson. pass this. You just take the phone. Okay.
Thank you.
Okay, the next thing is Peter Childers.
I'll speak on three issues. I guess the first one is Mr. Hsu's presentation, somewhat countering the very experienced and knowledgeable people at NCGS who, when they surveyed this line, realized that they had a legal obligation to get it right. And I don't think Mr. Hsu has discussed his recent findings with NCGS. I doubt very much that if he did discuss them with NCGS and they did the research, that I don't think his contentions would hold up very well. But I challenge him to take his information to NCGS if he wants to. And they could clarify. They've been through this many, many times. They know they have a legal obligation to get it right, and they don't make mistakes. They've been very experienced surveyors over the years. The other issue would be Mill Creek. Somehow the representative of Mill Creek thinks that a county line creates a community. I don't think that if this line had been established already and we weren't having this discussion, that the Mill Creek development would have stopped at the county boundary. I think they would have accumulated land on both sides anyway. And quite frankly, there are a lot more smart people that work for Mill Creek that probably knew this issue long before it came to head here, before everyone else knew it. And I think they knew what they were getting themselves into when they built the community, they built on both sides of the line. The other thing is, a line is not a wall, and it does not separate communities. A subdivision is a subdivision, whether there's a line through it or not. And so I don't buy that argument. The last argument seems to be one of affordability of paying for a survey. So is this the principle, then, that commissioners are going to operate under, that if you can afford to pay a surveyor to survey your land, that you're going to get your choice of county? I mean, I'd like to know what principles commissioners are ultimately going to decide this on, because my contention has always been one of fairness and treating everybody equally up and down the line, and so far I've not seen that. I've seen carve-outs in Mebane and Mill Creek, a very influential developer. The 9th Street people who, in the letter they got in 1976 or whenever it was, saying that, you know, you can pay your taxes in Alamance County, but that doesn't say where the line is. And quite frankly, Ms. Ann Rice says we've been paying taxes all these years. Well, they've been paying taxes illegally all these years to Alamance County. So I just want to get the understanding and just impress upon commissioners that what principles are you operating under to decide this issue? Because if it is one that you're going to say, well, we're going to say you're going to get the county of your choice if you pay for the survey, because we can't afford to pay for surveys now in the county. The economic times are not good. So where does that put that? For small landowners, that might be affordable, but what about for a larger landowner, like a farmer or somebody that has a lot of acres and paying that $2 or $3 or whatever we want to work out a foot? What if he's unwilling to pay? What if he's just unwilling to pay for the survey? Is he going to get booted in a county then because he's unwilling or can't afford to pay for the survey? So I think everybody kind of needs to look at the issue involved here, the fairness of the county, and what principle are the commissioners going to operate under to make this decision. So I've said my piece. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Childers. Okay, that's all of the public comments, and at this time I will close the public comments. Next is Brian Haygood with the Eli Whitney Recreation Center update.
Good evening, Commissioners. At the last meeting, the Board of Commissioners extended the Eli Whitney lease with the Alamance-Burnham School System until June 30th of 2010. At that same meeting, the Board asked that our department inform the community of the goings-on, give them a chance to provide some feedback to our department about the center. We've conferred with Dale Page, who's the chairman of our Parks Commission, and Dale has recommended, and we certainly support this too, that the next meeting of the Alamance County Parks Commission be held at the Eli Whitney Recreation Center, and that date is next Tuesday, December 15th. The time of the meeting will be at 6:30 p.m. So I'm here this evening to let you know we're following through with your desires to meet with the community, give them updated information about the center, its current status, and gauge their thoughts and get some feedback from them. You're all welcome to attend. That meeting has been advertised. That's a change in time. It's been advertised as well. So if you have any questions for me, I'll be happy to answer them, but my main goal tonight was to let you know that that meeting will be occurring next Tuesday night, and you are welcome.
Thank you for setting that up.
Yes, indeed.
Any more questions?
All right. Well, thank you very much.
Thank you, Brian. Thanks. And I noticed that Pleasant Grove is totally torn down other than the gym. I was out there this week.
Yes, they've made a lot of progress. They've taken down both wings, the boiler room, all that's been removed. Mm-hmm. They're in the process of removing the slab.
Looks so good out there.
Progress is being made.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Just wanted to bring that up, too. Next is mental health report, Mr. Dan Hahn.
Good evening. I don't know if it's right to say this or not, but as a citizen of Alamance County, thank you very much for doing what you did in terms of the start of the meeting. Very, very pleased to hear that. Thank you very much for the opportunity to sit and speak with you tonight in regards to the mental health challenges that are going on right now. You all have received at different points in time information in regards to some of the state initiatives, and I want to take the opportunity at this point in time to identify and thank both the Alamance-Caswell Area Board Chair, David Carter, who is here tonight, as well as Norman Melton, who is past chair of the NAMI group, which is an advocacy group. I really appreciate them both being here this evening as well, because these are some very challenging times that mental health is involved with at this point. You don't see me up here very often, simply because for the most part, an area authority functions within the auspices of the county, but at the same time is responsible for particular things. Having said that, one of the things that I wanted to tell you all about was your employees, okay? And as I sit here, and Craig and Amy and Clyde and Pat and Tim, they have all been very, very helpful to the Alamance-Caswell board in regards to things, and I wanted to publicly thank each and every one of them and let you all know, as their bosses, that they do an excellent job, and we're very happy and very pleased to have that relationship with Alamance County. Mental health reform, I don't know what to tell you. The intention was, in 2001, the idea of dissolving area programs, which Alamance County was involved with, and divesting those services, privatizing the services, and having them go out into the community to the best provider network. There's been a lot of attempts and a lot of iterations at different points in time. The Alamance-Caswell program, which has been a historic program involved with your community for over 40 years, was involved in a process where they went ahead and said, all right, we're going to be a local management entity. We need to merge with Rockingham County. We need to achieve a minimum population of not less than 200,000 covered lives. That was all successfully done back in 2005 and 2006. And we moved along, and we met the challenges, ever-changing challenges, I would go ahead and say, in terms of the mental health reform and what would be the newest iteration of the different things and going on. At a particular point in time in early in the year this year, we were notified by Rockingham County that they were going to go ahead and withdraw from participation in the Alamance-Caswell Rockingham local management entity, which left us under the 200,000 covered lives. And I would go ahead and say, without any notification to board members from Rockingham County who sat on this local management entity, and the very night that this was made, a public announcement at a board meeting, every one of the Rockingham members said, we had no idea that this was going on. Our community Rockingham County did not go to my board of directors, my bosses, and say, we have a concern, we have a problem, we have something that's going on. So consequently, I won't delve greatly into that, but it left us below that 200,000 minimum population. Law goes ahead and says that we can function as a local management entity for 1 year under general statute if a county withdraws. Okay, and so July 1 of 2009 to June 30 of 2010, we are protected under general statute. After that, if the agency continues to choose to function as a local management entity under the minimum population of 200,000, they will go ahead and they'll be given a 10% reduction in LME funding to basically incentivize a merger, a consolidation of a larger organization. We attempted to go ahead and work with Orange Person Chatham, which is another local management entity just to our east in Chapel Hill, and significant amounts of energy and time with board, with staff, with commissioners went into trying to meet that requirement and that merger, and it was unsuccessful. And I notified Linda as the chair that effort was unsuccessful and that we were going to go ahead and continue to be involved in the community. My board of directors wanted to go ahead and make sure that there were safety net services in the community and all of the relationships that we've established over the years in terms of the school system, in terms of the sheriff's department, in terms of the criminal justice and court system, the Department of Social Services, the health department, and anything else that you could think of. Each and every one of those programs were asking, okay, well, what's going to happen to our local management entity? I discussed this with our board of directors, and my recommendation to them was to continue on in terms of this next upcoming fiscal year, July 1, 2010, to June 30, 2011. And part of that process is the local management entity functions, but part of that process is also Alamance County has graced the local management entity with county dollars that we are able to provide psychiatric services and crisis services and safety net services that the community would not be afforded had you all as commissioners and my board of directors as a guiding principle go ahead and made that occur and happen. And so one of the things that I wanted to go ahead and say tonight, and I had this presentation, and I could go through every one of these PowerPoint things, but as I sat there and I thought about all this, I didn't really want to, you know, inundate you with a great deal of information or bore you or elongate your evening tonight. But generally speaking, what this particular presentation talks about is the idea of this is, and I don't know, am I supposed to put this up and go ahead and do this particular thing?
Sure.
Eyes going in.
You're fine.
Okay.
It's up to the chair.
Point shoot. Chair? Point shoot. I can't really see here.
That's what happens when you get old, Dan.
Yeah, I know. Oh, okay. 2001, one of the biggest problems in regards to this is the idea of the system talked about. We are required to give any willing and able provider the ability to go ahead and work in this system. Okay. The Medicaid services and the state dollar services are two separate things. And one of the things that I talked with people at the division, Raleigh, about was the idea that if you want to go ahead and address these issues, you have to do it in terms of a Medicaid service, which is an uncapped entitlement service, and then the state-funded service or the capped amount of dollars, you can't really treat them both the same way, and you're going to run into trouble. And the division's response to that was, well, thank you very much, but we have to do everything all at the same time. Requirements regarding consumer choice, provider appeals, and we were mandated against those financial logics. What I just said there was, I stood up and I went, you know what, I think this is really kind of a bad idea, and I think that we're going to run into trouble. And the division went ahead and said, we're under timelines, we have to implement this stuff, and we have to do it all in the same way, because the federal legislation goes ahead and says that Medicaid cannot be treated differently than the state-funded service. And so we all moved along in this process. In doing that, there was a particular service called community support that was embraced by unregulated providers, and they went ahead and in the fiscal year 2007-2008, we as a statewide system, ended up with a $1 billion price tag for community support services. The Legislative Oversight Committee, as well as the system in general, was kind of taken aback by the fact that, oh, in one service, we spent $1 billion. The LME met with the provider network and informed them, our provider network locally here, that the Medicaid standards would most likely require a comprehensive provider, not unlike historic area programs, doctor services, outpatient services, mental health services, services for people with developmental disabilities, all under one group. Before privatization, before provider network, that was what went on, and we went ahead and we talked with our provider in our community about that. These services are recognized and reimbursed via national Medicaid requirements. I missed something in that last slide, and I won't go back, but what I also talked about was you needed to form a comprehensive provider organization, and you also have to do best practice. You have to implement, when you're doing your treatment, there are all sorts of national standards that go ahead and say, if Dan has a particular diagnosis, the best national standard is for Dan to get this type of treatment, okay, as opposed to whatever that particular provider would like to get. And so we went ahead and said, make sure that you're doing quality services, make sure that you're doing best practice services. Federal payers are looking for outcome-based treatment models that are empirically based and nationally recognized. The North Carolina system applied for and gained a Medicaid managed care waiver in March of 2006. Expectations, groundwork, and provider rules were not established to coexist with the Medicaid managed care environment. Again, going back to, you can't do a dual system at the same time, but that's what North Carolina charged forward and tried to do, was a dual system at the same time. LMEs across the state were not given time, tools, training, or most importantly, division support to implement these things. At that particular point in time, the cry from Raleigh was, March of 2006, we've got to do this, we've got to do this, we've got to do this. And we kept saying, wait for a minute and be cautious about implementation. The division went ahead and said, we can't wait, because if we miss this opportunity, it will be a long time before the federal government again goes ahead and says, yes, North Carolina can do a Medicaid system. We warned the division in regards to this. Concerns and warnings were largely ignored by that same division. With the expenditures rising out of control and outcomes remaining stagnant or declining, the state took drastic action, cutting reimbursement for that community support, the program that we spent $1 billion on. They went ahead and said, you know what, how we go ahead and reduce that $1 billion is, we go from a reimbursement rate of $62 an hour to $45 an hour in March of 2008, retroactively back to July 1 of 2007. I had many providers come into me, and the larger providers were saying, hey, guess what? Based on that retroactive rate cut, we're gonna lose $1 million, or we're gonna lose $1.5 million. There was quite a bit of upheaval in the system. There was such an outcry and danger of losing services without replacements that a change was enacted to alter reimbursement rates again, and they went ahead and said it was $62, we're going to pay $45, and I think that it ended up being somewhere in the $52-$53 range. $55 million in terms of our economic downturn that we all are painfully involved with and aware of right now. $55 million in service dollars have been reduced from the mental health system to treat real people in our communities. $16 million was cut from CAP MRDD services for people with developmental disabilities. $4 million reduction in non-core community services, and reactionary tactics are placing communities at risk in terms of all of the economic impact, okay? And we don't, as a system, say, oh, well, we can't or shouldn't suffer an economic reality in terms of this, because this, just like anything nationally or locally, there are fiscal realities in regards to decreasing revenue receipts from taxes and from different things going on. Reduction or elimination of level 3 and level 4 group home placements for children and adolescents. These are some of the effects of this economic downturn. And for anybody who's in the community here, there was a descriptive communication that went out and says, hey, guess what? Anybody in a level 3 or level 4 home, and for anybody who doesn't know, level 3 and level 4 homes are for children in residential placement that need a very high level of intensive care in a level 3 or a level 4 home. The level 4 home is actually a locked facility. The level 3 home is 24-hour observation and services. The state went ahead and said, hey, guess what? Communicate out to the community and say, we're going to shut down every level 3 and level 4 home out there. And when the question was asked, and so what services are these children going to go ahead and get? They being the state, went ahead and said, well, we'll provide wraparound services, intensive in-home services for this type of thing. And certainly, I'll go ahead and tell you, as a reformed clinician myself, that there are some instances where that is very appropriate. There are other instances where that is absolutely inappropriate and puts both the child and the community at danger, in danger, in regards to the things that are going on. Community support was slated to be discontinued effective 10/12/2009. The near chancellor, secretary of the DHHS, moves back the community support discontinuation date to be effective January 1, 2010. I happened to be at a forum 2 or 3 months ago, and at that particular point in time, we were all concerned that October 12th seemed like a pretty aggressive timeline in terms of the discontinuation of a particular community support service. The secretary then went ahead and said, well, okay, you're right. What we're going to do is we're going to stop January 1, 2010. Questions arise about what will replace community support. Current response from the division at that time was, at this point, there is no replacement, and we're working on that right now. At the most recent NC Provider Council conference held in Greensboro, that's what I was just talking about, October 2009, Secretary Kanzler indicated 35 to 50,000 people receiving community support at this time will be impacted. 20% of these individuals are to be transitioned into another service, and each local management entity throughout the state of North Carolina has taken a look at that top 20%, meaning those individuals that need the most service and gain the most service from community support. Those individuals have been appropriately transitioned or planned to be transitioned into some other service. The question that I have for you, the question that I have for the community and for the division and for my board is, what happens to the other 80% of the people out there? 28 to 40,000 individuals, based on the January 1, 2010 discontinuation of community support, there will be no services for those individuals. That is going to impact our substance abuse providers, lack of qualified professionals to meet those requirements, and lack of incentives for substance abuse services for both adults and for kids. The comprehensive provider, and I'm sorry that I'm just jumping through this all so quickly here, but I had said a while ago, what did the area program used to do historically? All the services under one roof. And what the secretary is saying right now is we need to go to a comprehensive provider again to get all services provided under one roof. Now, whether you're a pendulum person talking about it swung all the way to privatization and now has swung back to the middle here, or you're a circular person in terms of it started here and now it's coming around the bend and it's coming back, I think that clinically the idea of comprehensive providers are a solid thing. But when you ask the secretary or you ask the mental health folk, what does that currently mean at this point in time, they're saying, we're working on that. We don't know for sure. And so a conversation that I had with Craig in regards to this particular thing was, my board is a little bit nervous right now in terms of what will occur and what will happen as far as this goes. Comprehensive providers basically just goes into what they are, meaning former area programs, and then some of the enhanced services that we talk about here, community support team, intensive in-home, substance abuse intensive outpatient program. Status of the local management entity. Alamance, Caswell, and Rockingham counties established their interlocal government agreement 2006. This agreement allowed for that $200,000. As I told you before, June 30, 2009, Rockingham withdraws, leaving a population in Alamance and Caswell County of 168,000 covered lives.
Hey, let me ask you a question.
Yes, sir.
What consequences does Rockingham County have by withdrawing? Are they penalized?
They have no consequence in terms of the general statute that talks about this, because what they did is they withdrew from the Alamance Caswell Rockingham program and they married up with the Centerpoint program, which is Davie, Forsyth, and Stokes.
So they just fell into another group at that point.
And I had talked to you about the general statute protecting us at this particular point in time. On November 4th, the Orange Person Chatham Board that I talked to you about officially withdrew their public intention to engage in further discussion regarding a merger between the two agencies. The local management entity will continue to maintain and enhance locally provided services, provide cost neutrally via the clinical arm of the organization. What this board of directors has always envisioned and what they always mandated for us as an organization was a small arm of clinical presentation in regards to things to address some of the gaps that we see our provider network not being able to do, or our local hospital, or our police department, or sheriff's department, the challenges that they have in regards to stuff. So we have been instructed by our board to go ahead and say, at least at some level, go ahead and provide some clinical safety net of services. The Alamance Caswell local management entity will continue to explore mutually beneficial partnerships in the development of enhanced safety net services. Meaning we understand and recognize that the idea of a merger and consolidation only reduces cost, only improves and helps the system as a whole, but our board is not willing to go ahead and abandon our community in regards to that. And so at the same time, we are developing and enhancing those safety net services that we have talked about from time to time. Just a few of the accomplishments and all of the tumultuous stuff that's going on here. CIT trainings. Those are law enforcement trainings that are going on and will continue to go on. One of the really neat things in regards to that is we've had a few of those trainings now. There have been members of your community, my community, have come back and said, hey, guess what? I have a loved one who has a mental health issue or a substance abuse issue, and when I had to call the police in order to engage in whatever, I asked them, do you have a CIT-trained officer? And in some cases, they were able to get a CIT-trained officer. And our relationship and our hope is that we continue to go ahead and provide that particular scenario, both for the Sheriff's Department as well as for all the other community municipal agencies out there. The development of a three-way contract with ARMC it was very, very large in terms of everything that goes on. There were 2,700 individuals who were diverted from the state institution. In other words, the state institution, Central Regional Hospital in Butner, went ahead and said, hey, guess what? We don't have any place for this individual to go. So you're going to have to go ahead back in your communities, whether it be through the law enforcement, whether it be through the local hospitals, you're going to have to go ahead and do the best you can do with that individual. And there are nightmare stories about hours and hours, days and days, that these individuals are shackled, handcuffed, sat in emergency departments somewhere. And this is unacceptable. It's unacceptable for the community. It's unacceptable for my board of directors. And so the idea of a three-way contract that went ahead and said our community now has a resource that goes ahead and says if there is no room at the inn, meaning the state hospital, we have, in not in every single case, but in most cases, we have the opportunity to place an individual who needs hospitalization at a local community hospital as opposed to being transported to the Butner Center. Now, one of the things that Sheriff has always said to me is the idea of, do you realize that I'm the one that has to provide transportation up to Butner? And do you realize that that's an hour and a half or 2 hour ride up there and back and so on and so forth? And so when we said, hey, guess what? We have a different alternative for that. He, along with every other police agency, said, you know what? This is a better deal. But with all due respect to all police officers and to the sheriff, the better thing about this is if you have a problem, if you decompensate, if you need to be hospitalized, the idea of you getting better, the idea of you being supported by your family, by your employer, by your community, is much better if you're placed locally in your hospital as opposed to sent somewhere 2 or 3 hours away. So that was a really, really good thing.
Mr. Hong.
Yes.
I add something just to put a little reality in this.
Yes. Yes, ma'am.
I understood, and this was several years ago, that Butner was closing and they were letting these people out. They were going out back into the community, excuse me. And like any other illness, once you start feeling better, don't we stop taking our meds? We all do that. I know I do because I don't like medicine. And these people, they don't have any, there's no oversight on what happens to them. They stop taking their meds. They're out there on the streets. They do things that are a little bit off base. They get picked up by law enforcement. They're taken down to the jail. Or the detention center. It's a bad situation, and it takes us back 50, 75 years, 100 years in mental health.
Yes, ma'am.
It's really tough.
Yes, ma'am. And one of the intentions of what we're trying to do is to go ahead in whatever small way we can impact that on a local basis, we're going to go ahead and we're going to continue to do that as long as my board goes ahead and gives us support and directive to do so. A new clinical review process. One of the things that I really wanted to let both the sheriff know about as well as the community know about is you hear about an individual who gets reviewed by an emergency department doctor and they say, okay, this person needs to go on commitment. They need to go to the state institution. But the state institutions are on deferral status all the time now. Okay? And so what happens, and I'll use the sheriff's department just as an example because Terry's right here, the sheriff sits at the local emergency department with the individual whether it be hours or whether it be days, okay? And one of the things that we went ahead and worked with ARMC about, and I want you all to know that ARMC was key and critical. John Curran and everybody else over there was critical in regards to this, was we went ahead and we said, hey, let's go ahead and have a proactive local plan that says, here's the doctor, here's a couple nurses, here's a mental health professional from the local management entity. Let's go ahead and take a look at the individual, assess them again. Now, this is normally on a Friday night or a Saturday night. Individuals come in and they get petitioned and they sit there forever. Well, if there's no place for them to go, then law enforcement has to sit with that individual hour after hour, day after day. Well, what we went ahead and did is, at least Monday through Friday, we have a clinical team that's working together, both from the hospital as well as from the local management entity, and a doctor goes ahead and says, does Dan still need to be under commitment, or has Dan now calmed down or sobered up or done whatever? And that is usually the case in those types of situations. So a doctor goes back to the original petitioner in the emergency department, and a doctor to doctor says, Dan's okay to no longer be on commitment. And in many cases now, we have gotten people off commitment and gotten them into more appropriate, locally based, clinically effective means of things going on. And I haven't had the conversation yet with either the local departments or with the sheriff right now, but my hope is they are no longer being inundated or stressed as much as they were. Okay? And that was the intention of this particular process. That's what we'll continue to try and do in this process. Reduction in patient wait time, community placement with better follow-up, decreased demand on the emergency department, increased in psychiatric resources for the community. I've talked about that in terms of the three-way contract and beds over at ARMC now. Participation and collaboration with the systems of care application development and enhancement. You've had Susan come here on a number of occasions, talk about all the really innovative things that are going on. And one of the neat things about this community is everybody sits there and goes ahead and says, what is in the best interest of this community? And we are a very happy and very proud partner in regards to that process. Enhanced walk-in services are some of the clinical things that we talked about. Aftercare follow-up for patients discharged from the hospital. One of the biggest things that happens is when an individual goes into the hospital and they come back out, if they don't get the care right away, if they don't get the follow-up right away, then more than likely they're just going to return and end up right back at the hospital again. So one of the things that we did was establish a discharge hospital discharge patient care right within the quarters of what's going on. We have a psychiatrist Monday through Friday every day, what we would go ahead and say is the first quarter data indicates that zero readmissions into the state facility. In other words, that revolving door that the system in general is experiencing right now, we have stopped in terms of, yes, people go to the hospital, but people don't go back into the hospital in that particular first quarter of data. And we were the only program in the central region, seven local management entities, to have that zero readmission into that state institution. Collaboration with the school system, they're looking right now at a day treatment program. This is for school-age children that have both academic issues as well as mental health or substance abuse issues, working very, very closely with them. Continue to work housing authority to address homelessness that affects everybody in the area. Grant writer to increase safe and affordable housing options for citizens in the community. Numerous seats on the community-based boards, as I mentioned to you. Very, very happy to be a part of all of the different things that we're doing in Alamance County. We're fiscally conservative. We've got an excellent finance team. We've also got an excellent finance committee of the board who sits there and takes a look at everything that we do all the time, which is why we have the opportunity to continue to provide psychiatric services and some of the walk-in services that we have alluded to here. These and other accomplishments have been achieved while the state system is in constant turmoil, as I mentioned to you. County funding has been reduced from a high of $2.6 million, and I don't know exactly when that was, but this was a historic scenario. Current contributions are $1.3 million, and again, my board and my program thank you all very much for what it is that you do provide for the citizens of Alamance County. The future, the local management entity is mindful of the economic times our community and state and nation face. We are very appreciative of all the support that the commissioners have provided throughout the years, contributions, in-kind facilities, and service supports. Not just the dollars that you all provide for this particular program, but also the sites and the in-kind stuff has been massive in terms of what we've been able to do. Our nation and our community have seen and will continue to see an increase in demand for accessible, high-quality services. More people will need services to cope with issues pertaining to these mental health issues that are going on. Both veterans returning from conflicts overseas and families impacted by loss of jobs are increasing demand for reasonable short-term care. The current mental health system are ill-equipped to go ahead and handle these issues in a caring and competent, effective manner. And the reason for that is those private providers that are out there are going ahead and saying, and what is your payer source? What does your insurance card say? Okay. And if you don't have a payer source, if you don't have an insurance card, if you don't have dollars to go ahead and pay for that service, you're told, well, thank you very much. You just go out, good luck, and God bless. Okay. That's one of the reasons why we're trying so desperately to continue a public safety net of these services. And what will the end result be? Increased demand on any and all of the services that we've talked about before, all the partners that we've talked about before, in terms of the Sheriff's Department, county jails, judicial systems, public agencies, local emergency department. These will all begin to see even increase greater the pressure that's out there. The future, what we're proposing to do. Solid preliminary budget projections indicate that because of historically conservative practices, the Alamance-Caswell LME will be able to withstand said 10% reduction in this upcoming July 1, 2010 to June 30, 2011 year, with no impact on our ability to maintain current staff and to meet the requirements outlined in the fiscal year 2010-2011. These numbers will be presented to the Alamance-Caswell Board of Directors Finance Committee for review and endorsement. It's already been done. It's already been reviewed by the board, and the board has given direction to go ahead and move forward in this particular scenario. We respectfully request your support to remain a viable member of our community. General statute indicates that the program will receive this 10% reduction in the LME administrative funding for this next upcoming year if we do not comply and merge with another local management entity to meet the minimum 200,000 population. And what I would go ahead and say to you is that is our intention, that is our direction, that is what we would like to do as an Alamance-Caswell Area Authority Board of Directors. And what I come to you all as commissioners tonight about here is to inform you about what it is that we're doing, the challenges that we currently face as a community, and then ask for your support in regards to allowing us to move forward with this planned process, and hopefully to get your endorsement, a public endorsement or public support to go ahead and allow the Alamance-Caswell program to move on into the 2010-2011 year. And if there are any questions that you all have,
let me ask you a question. With Rockingham County pulling out and going to another district,
yes, sir.
Are we better off only losing 10% rather than a third? Am I confused?
The third that you refer to, Commissioner, is the idea of population.
Right.
The 10% is actually the fiscal dollars that will be associated in this upcoming year. And so the two are different in terms of the 100,000 covered lives is one-third versus the 10% reduction is different.
So it doesn't have any correlation between the
correct, two? Correct, yes. Any other questions?
Not really. In your agreement with the hospital, I mean, this is already developed. Am
yes.
I reading that
yes.
right?
Absolutely. And so we're in the second year
of
this contract. Yes.
I heard Mike Watson speak
yes.
not long ago, and he said that's what their plan is at the state level to implement 10 beds at a time in the communities. And it sounded like you all got to jump on.
We were actually one of the very first who did it, and it wasn't really so much anything other than we looked at the opportunity, the dollars were out there, and again, I cannot reiterate the amount of support and the amount of participation from the Alamance Medical Regional Center. It was basically the perfect storm in
right.
terms of their emergency department was inundated with people coming into the emergency department, and they're going, Dan, help us somehow. And these dollars were available, and we were able to work quickly and effectively to go ahead and.
Well, I got to witness firsthand what you're talking about, tying up officers. My
yes.
mother was in the hospital
yes.
over there in the emergency room.
Mm-hmm.
And we were there for 4 hours. There were three Burlington PD in there with this one guy. Then, of course, the sheriff, after about 8 hours, they finally, I mean, because we were there a long time, but
right.
it took about 8 hours to take this patient and get him out and take him to Butner or wherever they were going with
yes.
him.
Yes, sir.
I mean, it's a lot of man hours we're losing from law enforcement that maybe we're not even recognizing those costs.
All law enforcement has come to the local management entity and said, understand that not only is it a fiscal strain, but also it's officers that are supposed to be out on the street protecting the community are not out on the street protecting the community because they're in these local emergency departments doing this stuff.
Now, after they get out of the care treatment there, do they work back and forth with the treatment program there as a patient? Or?
That's one of the important things in terms of our own safety net services is we have a psychiatrist. When that individual comes out of the state institution or a hospital, the very first thing that they do is they see our doctor, and then from there, if an appropriate provider is out there, then what we do in care coordination is make sure that that appointment happens, make sure that they continue on. If they don't have a provider, then we go ahead and we provide that ourselves within our own clinical arm of the organization.
Well, Mr. Carter would like this to...
Yes, just as chairman of the LME, I just want to echo everything that Dan has said. We certainly appreciate the commissioner's support during these stressful times. As you can imagine, we have a small staff compared to what it used to be historically in the county, and that staff, those people there in that building every day, have done an enormous amount of work. They've gone above and beyond what we have required of them as board of directors. We have asked them to put in an enormous amount of hours, and they have done so, and that's why you see some of the accomplishments that we have. It is our goal not to lose some of these services here in this county. We want to keep something here, and some may ask why we have not paired up or married up with another county OPC or someone else. We don't want to prematurely do that and be faced with another situation like we were with Rockingham. And so we feel as the times are changing, and they are rapidly changing in Raleigh, we don't know from 1 month to the next what's going to happen, that it may be best just to take this 10% cut. Not that we're going to sit back on our heels and just coast on down the road. We're very proactively working, looking at all options while maintaining services. And one thing that I think maybe to everyone in the room, sometimes we see statistics as it was presented very well, and we see numbers and we see all these digits, and I want to remind everyone, these are people's lives
yep.
associated with every one of these statistics. This level 3 and level 4 homes, that is a major concern. Where does that 80% go? The sheriff sees them at the sheriff's department. The ER is full, and that's why our joint efforts with ARMC is so crucial and so important. So we appreciate the support of the commissioners and ask that you continue to give support, and we'll keep you updated as Dan has done, and it's hard work ahead of us.
Well, I would like to say, too, that Dan and I met with the Orange County LME, and what I got out of it when we met with them was, first of all, I don't know that their finances are in good enough shape for us to collaborate with them. And when we left, or when I left, I had the thoughts that we did not need to merge with them because we would really not have a big voice because it would be five counties. I think it's four now. Am I right, Dan?
Three.
Mm-hmm. And it would be four counties that would be there. Mm-hmm. And we would lose a lot of people here, a lot of support here, too, that we would get. So I certainly support what we are trying to do with this LME, is to keep continuing here rather than try to merge with OPC. So.
Madam Chair, if I probably, and Dan, correct me if I'm wrong, probably I think which would help the LME is a motion from this board supporting the current direction of the LME, basically that we support that they don't jump in head first in looking at any merger, that it, you know, that we don't request, even though they're going to be losing 10%. On the flip side of that, for the county, it's important to know that they will not be asking the county to make up that difference in loss. So they're going to be asking in the upcoming budget, the current allocation, which it is $1.3 million. So I think in order to help Dan, if the board supports that direction, that it be put in the form of a motion.
All right. I'll entertain a motion at this time.
So moved.
And second. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Thank you, Dan.
Thank you very much.
Okay. Next thing on our agenda is the crime report from Sheriff Johnson.
Before I get into the crime report, a couple things I'd like to say. I'd like to just reiterate what Mr. Hahn has said. Everything he said here has been totally correct, and we're inundated with what's. We got an officer right now at 5:30, went to the hospital. He's still sitting there, and probably by midnight night he'll still be sitting there. And we have seven officers on the road at night. That means one's gone, maybe two. So it does make a difference. And I'm going to go a step further than what he said. I wish Alamance County would stand alone and look after our people and let everybody else look after theirs. That's just the way
that might be what we have to do.
We're heading that direction.
Well, I certainly hope so.
I'm a man of fear.
Good to know we have the backing of the sheriff's.
Well, I'm telling you, we deal with this every day. I mean, Mr. Hahn knows we have talked over and over, and they've provided CIT training for our officers, and we deal with it in jail. So I'll get going. Also, I want to commend the commissioners on the action you took tonight. Mr. Sutton, I've always said, you're a very smart man in a lot of ways. When you come in here and you ask the person a question up here, you already know the answer because you've done your homework. And what you've done tonight was very commendable. I want you to understand it.
Thank you.
And to all of you, I'm proud you are Board of Commissioners.
Thank you.
Okay, I'm supposed to do a crime report tonight. So we're going to get started. First of all, this is our 2008 crime report. It goes from January to January. Our 2009 will be ready, and we'll do an in-depth review of our crime in Alamance County around February or 1st of March. So we'll get started here. First of all, this is from the United States Census. I think it may be a little more than what they show here, but our population in Alamance County is 148,053 people. That's the 2008 estimate. And that's residents that are here legally. 18th most populated county in North Carolina. I bet that's a shock to some of you. 18th most populated county. And our service population, the Sheriff's Department, is 59,251. And that's by our North Carolina Uniform Crime Report. That's what the Sheriff's Department has to service as far as calls for service out in the county. That does not cover the civil papers we serve in the city, a lot of times our warrants, our executions, and this is just our patrol primary service population. 2008, the overall crime rate decreased by less than 1% from the previous year in Alamance County. In 2008, the violent crime rate increased by 29.8% from the previous year. In 2008, the property crime rate decreased by 3.49% from the previous year. Alamance County ranked 91st out of 397 reporting law enforcement agencies in North Carolina based on index crime rate. And I think that's good. You know, we hope to do better, but as you'll see when we go on, I'm very proud of our men and women. Okay, 2007 crime index. You see the orange portion here. The same problem occurred in 2007 that occurred with our traffic stop data when we were switching over from positron. A lot of that was lost. Riley has made a note of that. And these numbers here is what we have pulled out from a hand search by Chief Deputy Britt and some of the people at the Alamance County Sheriff's Office. As you can see, that we had a total of 1,440 index crimes in 2007.
What was all that about? Is it from August to September and October? Is that
is where the statistic did not get through the firewalls, go to Riley, like I suppose it was because of positron. I can tell you right now, okay. I raised Cain when this county started to go to positron, and I was told that positron, you know, I didn't have any say in it, and we knew that it was not a proven system. Uh-huh. And guess what? We're now on OSSI, which is a proven system. And we now, and you'll see our statistics are changed, and everything is great. So that's where we had 440 index crimes in 2007. 2008, you look down at the bottom, we had 14 and 31. So it's a slight decrease from there. Now, this is our index crimes, which covers murder, rape, robbery, aggravated assault, burglary, larceny, motor vehicle theft, property, etc. Some crimes are not on there. Your DWIs, your other certain other crimes that are not on there. And look at it real good. Oh, boy, this is good. Anyway, we are 8 out of 25 departments with comparable size populations. We're 8, which I think is very good of Alamance County, especially for the fact that we have two major interstates running north, south, east, west, and it brings a ton of crime here that some of these other agencies do not have. So I think we're in good shape there. As you can see, we have our population, our index crime was 2,415.1. You say, well, how do you get 0.1? It's based on per 100,000. So they take the formula with 59,000 population, and that's how they come up with that particular number. Okay, this is our clearance rate. I'm very proud. However, I've told my family, I'm very proud of you, but that's not good enough. We've got to get better. As you can see, murder, we had 100% clearance in 2008. Rape, you say, well, how in the world did you clear 120%? We cleared one that happened the year before, so it's figured into the stats. Robberies, 56.3. Of course, I won't go, you just go over and look and you can see. But here's what's really interesting. Statewide clearance rate 2008 index crime. Alamance County, if you'll look, you can see there the state average, we had 597 murders, 479 cleared, for a state rate of 80.2%. Alamance County Sheriff's Office had 100%. We had 120% rate. If you'll look at the Alamance County Sheriff's Office versus the rest of the state, you can see we beat in every category, we were ahead. I see it. Now we're going to show you something even better. Okay, U.S. percentage cleared, North Carolina cleared, now Alamance County Sheriff's Office cleared. I would like you all to look at that. Very good. We exceed the clearance rate, but to me that's still not good enough. I'd like to say 100%, 100%, 100%, 100%. And my people tell you that I stay on, but they do a good job. And we're very proud of that. Any questions about this right here? And these are the statistics that were provided by our index crime nationally and state. Okay, summary. Overall index crime, statewide ranking, Alamance County Sheriff's Office is 91st of 397 reporting agencies in the state. Overall violent crime, statewide ranking, Alamance County Sheriff's Office is 188 of 397 reporting agencies. We're about middle there. But we're going to get better. Overall property crime statewide ranking, Alamance County Sheriff's Office is 84 of 397 reporting agencies. And we you know, like I said, we have some problems that the rest of these agencies don't have. And one of the biggest things are major interstates. That's why the drugs seem to come here. The state of North Carolina is saying they hire clearance rate for indebted crimes than the national average. In turn, the Alamance County Sheriff's Office exceeded the state clearance rate in all indebted crime categories. The Alamance County Sheriff's Office will provide a 2009 annual report to the commissioners in early spring of 2010. And I pretty hurriedly, but that's it. Are there any questions?
Just one. What percentage of crime would you say, of all the crime across the board, is linked to drugs? Either you're buying them, you're selling them, you're stealing them.
I can tell you right now, and like I would have to go back and say it, but I would say between 80 and 95%, somewhere in that category. You go over to our jails, just like Mr. Hahn can tell you, with mental health issues, we have people in there because of dealing drugs, stealing to get drugs, robbing to get drugs, or family abuse because of drugs and alcohol, probably 80, 95% of that jail population as a result somewhere along the line of the drug problem in this nation.
I've always heard 80 plus, yeah.
Yes, sir. And I think that is pretty good. If you don't believe it, come over and talk to the people in jail there.
that's pretty obvious.
Sure.
Any questions?
Thank you, Sheriff.
Thank you for your presentation. That was good.
The next thing on our agenda is Stage 1 Adaptive Management Plan. Jordan
Lake. This will be put on the web page, too, sometime.
Mail a copy to Elon.
Sir?
Mail a copy to Elon.
Back in Carolina, sir.
Mr. Martin. This is a Adaptive Management Plan for Jordan Lake Rules.
Madam Chair, Commissioners, good evening. I'll be very brief with you all tonight. Of course, be glad to take questions. What you have before you is the Stage 1 Adaptive Management Plan for the Jordan Lake Rules. And just to kind of bring you up to speed a little bit on that, of course, the governor signed the rules in the law in June of 2009. And what came out of the Jordan Lake Rules was basically a compromise. It was a little bit less restrictive than what was originally proposed, where there was a lot of talk of doing retrofitting to existing development and things like that. And as part of the compromise that was negotiated apparently in the state house, we were given the opportunity to do a Stage 1 Adaptive Management Plan, which would identify potential retrofitting opportunities, and assuming that the area meets its goals, meaning everything in the Hall River arm of the watershed, if they meet their nutrient reduction loading requirements, they would not have to do retrofitting. However, we would have to prepare hypothetically some guidelines.
Jason, before you go any further,
yes,
may I interrupt?
Yes, ma'am.
We discussed it earlier, but for the sake of the folks here or that will be viewing this on television later, can you very briefly, in simple terms, explain retrofitting?
Retrofitting would be to existing development. Say, for example, you have a subdivision, housing development, and there's nothing in that development to control runoff water. Some may use what's called a best management practice, and that could be a wet detention pond, could be a grass swale. There's several different techniques that you can use to actually treat the nutrients in the runoff water before, and the theory is that it would basically clean the water before it hits the creeks and then goes into the drinking supply. It would at least reduce it before it gets there, and thereby having an effect on the entire watershed. That's the theory behind it. The Stage 1 Adaptive Management Plan, there were five tasks that we were basically asked to look at. One, task one, was public education and public awareness, and I won't read through all of this, but just kind of summarize what we already do. And this was just in general with the Adaptive Management Plan. The approach that I took was the approach of least change possible, and also the least cost possible as well. We currently are already involved with the Piedmont Triad Water Quality Partnership. Prior to that, we were in Stormwater Smart, and Some of you may recall at the budget retreat a few years back, I had mentioned that we would look at doing switching over because of the cost that was involved. And I, at the time, didn't feel that Stormwater Smart really offered us, the council of governments really wasn't offering us a product that was worth the money we were putting into it, to be blunt with you. And so we looked at the other Piedmont Triad Water Quality Partnership, which is basically run through the city of Greensboro. And there's several counties and cities that do that. And if you've seen some of the commercials on Channel 2 and all with the frog and so forth, those are some of the TV commercials they do. But we are currently still participating with them. The Council of Governments has revamped their Stormwater Smart program. They have a new coordinator now that's over it, and they are interested in us possibly rejoining them. And I believe, as I said in the plan, we will consider that and remain open to it, but I feel that we need to take the product that's the best for the county's dollar and consider that year to year. Task number two, mapping current stormwater infrastructure. Very simple, we don't have any stormwater infrastructure in our jurisdiction, so therefore we don't have anything to map. But if there were any kind of BMPs put in place or anything like that in the future, of course, we would need to map that. Number three, identify and remove illicit discharges. And this basically would be failing on-site wastewater systems for the county, and also the issue of straight piping. And I worked with Carl Carroll on this section to come up with the language here. Basically, environmental health currently already tracks failing wastewater systems, and they do address straight piping on a complaint basis. One of the things that we would need to add is a formal complaint mechanism, maybe something on the website that could be submitted. I think it's something that could be done fairly easy with the resources we currently have. Task number four, identify opportunities for retrofits and other projects to reduce nutrient loading on developed land. And this section pretty much took a lot of this from their guidelines. And right now, the planning department, we have kept, at least since I've been the since I was even the interim planning director, I've been keeping up with subdivision plats as we review them, so I can tell how many lots we've recorded in a year, what the name of the subdivision was, and how large the subdivision is. There was some record keeping of the sort prior, but it was a little more hit and miss, I guess, for lack of better words. But now, as we review a plat and sign off on it, there is a record made, and we keep up with that. And so basically, I think we could identify areas that are closer to streams and closer to the Hall River and use those as potential retrofitting sites. And then also commercial development that we know about that comes through building inspections could be looked at. The checklist that you have here, this is actually the guidelines that would have to go into this report. And the retrofitting is done, identifying retrofitting opportunities is done based on the population in the watershed area. With Alamance County, pretty much the entire county will be in that watershed, with the exception of a very small portion of land in the northeastern corner of the county. So anything over 60,000 in population, you have to do four of these in a year. And I feel pretty safe to say we're going to have to do four in a year. And these would have to be designed, and this would be the information that an engineer would have to put forth in a report to them. And just to kind of give you some idea on cost, I did take the liberty to just kind of ask ballpark figures of an engineer what this would cost. And for the entire, to do all four of them in a year, give or take, probably roughly around $5,000. So that, I was kind of surprised that it was that little. But right now we have, and just kind of go over the finances of the planning department, currently in our professional services budget, we have $3,000 already set aside for the Piedmont Triad Water Quality Partnership. That's already in there, and we already use it. And I roughly keep, there's $5,000 in that budget, and the other $2,000 was used for the Paradise Club that was part of the background checks and so forth. And I don't believe we're going to need that at this point, so we can divert that into this as well. But it will require a small increase in that portion of the budget, unless, of course, it's moved under a different budget, which we'll be tackling those issues in the coming months. So,
see where this cost will go up from this $5,000?
I think that's on the high end. The amount I was given was between roughly $3,500 and $5,000, so I'm erring on the side of caution there.
No, I'm talking about further down the road.
Oh, further down the road. With the cost of inflation, possibly, depending on their services, they may go up 10% every year or something like that, give or take a little. That's typically what I try to budget when it comes for inflation on cost. So. And then number five, develop a program to ensure maintenance of BMPs implemented by the county. And this was of a particular importance to me as well, and I will kind of read straight from this. Presently, Alamance County does not have any regulations as to the responsibility of maintenance of BMPs, nor does the county own or operate any BMPs. Alamance County does not allow high-density development in water supply watershed areas within its jurisdictions, meaning any of our existing watersheds, we don't allow high-density development anyway. Therefore, structural stormwater BMPs have not been required. Development that has occurred in the county outside of the water supply watershed areas may be subject to post-construction requirements of Session Law 2006-246, and may have structural BMPs. The state is responsible for issuing permits in Alamance County for development subject to this session law. Permits issued by the state require annual inspections of BMPs be maintained on the site by permittees. So currently, this is a big thing with the Phase 2 MPDES. We've been exempt on that from day one. And those things have been issued straight from the state and should remain there. Now, assuming we have to, under the new guidelines, when we get a model ordinance, because we have not received that yet either, we may have to require BMPs, and then at that point, we will need to put something into place as to who's going to own and maintain them, and how we're going to do that. And I've already got my thoughts on that would be to move it into the responsibility of the developer, very similar to the way we do roads. You can't get any permits, can't record your plat or anything until you post a bond or build it. And then require them to submit maintenance reports every year. Otherwise, it would be the county taking over the ownership and therefore the maintenance, and also having to hire an engineer to inspect them every year. So that's kind of where I'm looking at right now. But until we have that issue to worry about, I think it's best to not. So.
Any questions for Mr. Martin? Do I hear a motion that we adopt this management plan?
I'll make a motion.
Proposed?
We do.
I have a motion. Second. All in favor?
Thank you, Jason.
Thank you. Madam Chair, if I may, yes, just to kind of tell you where this is going to go from here, we will submit this now to the Environmental Management Commission, in Raleigh, and it is subject to their review. I did give this to the folks at Diener to look at, and they seem to be okay with it, but all bets are off when it comes to the EMC. So if they do require changes to this, they have 6 months to review it and submit them to us.
Okay.
And at that point, then we have 2 months to respond to it, and it just kind of goes from there.
Okay. So. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Okay. Next is Mr. Albright with the county line issue.
How long have we been fighting this county line?
100 years.
How long have we been fighting?
160. I thought we had it straightened out about 4 years ago.
Well, I think straight is the key word.
Amen.
I think what's happened is that since I've been involved, we passed a resolution 2 years ago this month for the geodetic survey folks to locate the existing county line. And Orange County passed the same resolution, and we referred to the state statutes, specifically General Statute 153A, 18A, 18C, and the North Carolina Chapter 102.1, which is the survey statute for the state. And what they did, they went and found the line. They located it. You've heard from folks tonight that talk about how cheap it's going to be to move the line. If I can refer to both proposals and direct your attention to both proposals from R.S. Jones, they based their survey, in parentheses here, it says, including tying the survey to the existing North Carolina geodetic survey line from 2008. So the surveyors are saying, yeah, they recognize what the statute says. The line's been located. If this board wants to move it, then the appropriate way to do that is to have a surveyor present a survey to you showing how it's going to be moved, explaining the rationale for moving it. Then you take that survey down to Raleigh and give it to the General Assembly, because the General Assembly is the only one that can move the line. In 1989, that's what happened in Mecklenburg and Iredell County. They passed local legislation that actually submitted it to a referendum. The piece of land in Mecklenburg County was around Lake Norman, extended about 300 feet out, and they called it Mech Neck. And they went to their legislative delegation and they said, why don't we get a local legislation to let the voters decide in that area? That's one way of handling it. I think it's an appropriate way to do it, and the legal way to do it is to ratify the line as the geodetic survey has located it, adopt it, because you've got a deadline coming up. January 1st, all property in Alamance County has to be listed for taxes. So you're going to have to use the line now that you know exists, and people are going to have to list their taxes. The legislature is not going to be in session until the 12th of May of 2010. So you got a 5-month period there. The statutes require the county commissioners to make sure that all property is listed and taxes are collected. What happens if you don't? Well, you're personally liable for it, according to the statute. If you don't collect taxes on property within the county, Chapter 105 says the board is liable. I don't know of any case where that's actually happened, but it's out there.
Eddie can pay it.
Yeah, I was hoping we'd get to keep the part that, you know, was actually ours. We've been taxing as Alamance.
Well, I've talked to the Guilford County attorney. He called me this weekend. Mike Barber has been hired by Guilford County to handle this issue. I explained to him what my rationale was. Now, Guilford passed the same resolution that Orange and Alamance passed, asking the geodetic survey folks to locate the line. And they did. They located it in Guilford as well. So I think the appropriate thing to do is take it in the proper steps, ratify the survey, then you know where it is. And if the citizens want to move it and the board decides, yes, it should be moved, then they come to you with the survey. You can adopt it, take it to the delegation down in Raleigh, or take it to the Orange Board, let them pass a resolution. Then it goes to Raleigh, and if the rest of the 98 counties in the state want to move the line, they move the line. And that's the proper way to do it. But if you go ahead and jump ahead and start making new surveys based on tax maps, then you're really no further ahead than you were in 1849 or 2007 when we asked the geodetic survey folks to come and find the line. There is one other thing. Mr. Childers spoke tonight. Mr. Childers brought an action against Orange County, and the court in Orange County determined that the United States Geographical Survey line was the county line, and this geodetic survey line matches it. So you've got to overcome that hurdle as well. So, I think the best, the prudent thing to do, and what I'm going to advise the board to do, is ratify the survey and listen to your constituency out here. If you want to move it, let them present a map showing where they want to move it. Then you have your baseline nailed down. You send your tax notices out like you're supposed to do, and it's just going to work a lot smoother. And I think your delegation down to Raleigh is going to want to see a survey. They're going to want to see an actual survey. The one in Mecklenburg County, the one I referred to earlier in 1989, they actually produced a survey and presented it to the General Assembly for adoption. So that's what's going to happen. I'll try and answer any questions you have.
Would it be out of order if I made a motion that we have a work session on this?
How many of those things have we sit through? Good Lord, Ann.
Bill, we haven't.
We need to make a decision. That's what we get elected to do, is make decisions. Let's make a decision. And let the people vote us out of office if they don't like it.
Well, if you want to ratify the line, it can be changed. In fact, the lines are changed from the history of this state from 1663. Hundreds of times. In fact, in 1897, a piece of Chatham County was brought into Alamance County by act of the legislature. So it can happen, and counties have been dissolved in this state. Polk County was dissolved and then reestablished. So they're creatures of the legislature, and really all you're doing is ratifying what you've asked the Geodetic Survey folks to do, and they've done it to the best of their ability using the technology they have. They have located the monuments and several others, and both in Alamance and Guilford. If you ratify that survey, that doesn't stop you from listening to the folks that want to make a change. It's just a step in the process. But what I'm telling you is you've already got the line. The Geodetic Survey, which is a branch of the state government, they're a branch of NC Diener, they have said, here's where the line is. Now, the tax statutes require us now to send tax bills out to everybody in Alamance County. So you're going to be in a bit of a dilemma, because the legislature doesn't come into session until May. Now, I think that gives these groups we've heard from tonight time to get their surveyors out there, come up with a map, come up with a rationale, to convince this board and the Orange Board to change it.
Everything can be changed in the future, can
it? It can be. I mean, like I say, if you look at the history of the counties, it's changed many, many times over the last 250 years.
Former inquiry with Dog Wright. Are you moving towards a vote on this tonight?
Yes.
I'm recommending the chairman.
I have one thing. I asked for this, okay, and I want to ride. Are those markers visible? Can we see them with our naked eye, or have we got to have, hold on one second, or do we have to have something else that
Where's
we...
my survey man? Bruce, come on up here.
We called Dennis Lee at the NCGS, and they said those monuments are in the ground. They're 6 feet spikes, but they're actually just below the surface. There is a sign out Hebron Church that kind of shows that, as I understand it, surveyors have all the equipment to take you right to it, and they kind of put it below the surface because, as I was told by Dennis Lee, that so regular surveyors can tie into it, but other people don't move them, those kind of things. It must be a modern way of dealing with it now. But that's
so people won't move you.
Well, they can be moved. I saw one at the southern end of Guilford County. It was the guy said I used to stand on it.
The concrete one on my car.
That's down around the Randolph line. Yeah, that was.
They can't be moved, but.
That's illegal.
Well,
it's illegal to speed, too.
Well, before we vote, I'd like to wait till next time anyway, because I want to go ride and see these, because I did ask for this, and this is the first time I've seen it tonight. So I would like to go ride and see these markers. Can we go do that, or can we see them, or what we need? We need a Geiger counter, or what do we need?
Get one of the guys from North Carolina.
If you don't mind.
One of the guys from
North Carolina.
Yeah, because, I mean, you know, if this is what we're going to vote on, then I want to see where these markers are.
Okay.
You know, I don't want to just say, oh, yeah, here it is, and it's marked on this map. I want to go see it. So if that's the case, okay.
Well, Madam Chair, if I can make just one comment. Somebody said that one of the commissioners was running on the platform of moving a line. I've never said I want to move a line. I would like it to be accurately located. I would like the people that have been thinking for years and years they are in a county to remain in that county if they so choose. I think you're correct. We do have to have a baseline to work from. Mm-hmm. I do agree with that part. But as said before, there has been instances before where their lines have been changed. And actually, I called Craig today about talking to Mr. Curl because he was in Wake County as tax administrator. We have some tax administration and things that are going to have to happen. And a lot of this whole issue has started in the tax department. Excuse me, Gerald, for that.
It did start in the tax department.
And we need to clarify the, some of the points to get it clear in that department, because that's what happened over the years and just got so convoluted up that line. And everybody said, well, here's the line, and nobody really knew where the line was.
Well, I think that everybody knew where the line was. It was just different people from different counties that controlled the tax, you know, did it as a personal favor.
Well, I've talked to surveyors because dealt with the Guilford line. Problem was, you didn't have
a survey of a
property. You've got a four corners, right, and you can close in that whole survey. You start at one corner.
Madam Chair, wouldn't a vote like this take a vote here?
I have no idea.
What was the question?
A vote on issues require a public hearing on the issue before you have it.
How many public hearings have we had?
You haven't had one with me. No,
you've had a resolution to...
Just because you wasn't there don't mean it didn't happen.
We got a
date,
sir.
We got a date?
I don't think a motion's been made to ratify the survey.
Think Linda's correct. We may need to look at it more, but I do lean to what you're saying there.
Yeah. I think it's a step. It's just one step.
Yeah.
But I think it's the right
step. I just want to go look because I did ask for this.
That's fair. That's fair.
And then we'll bring it back up at the next meeting. Is that?
I like to ask one question. Is there a precedent out there at all? Not that I believe we have to always follow a precedent, but it's nice to know it. As a geodetic survey group, have they ever been shown to be wrong at all in the state of North Carolina?
Not that I'm aware of. The baseline survey statute is in Chapter 102. It was established in 1927 because there were some problems with surveying techniques. All of this goes back to the Meade Ranch in 1866 after the War for Southern Independence. That was the point where they established the survey because the country was growing towards the west. And they took that and in later years tried to incorporate it into the eastern part of the country, and it just didn't work because people forgot that the earth was not a perfectly round ball. It's more egg-shaped. So in 1927, and I'm going back into the history of this because I've spent 2 years studying it, they came up with this baseline datum, and it has been updated. I think in 1983 was the last time it was updated. But now we have satellite technology that flies over. The geodetic survey people have access to two or three satellites that fly over the earth and can pinpoint this stuff with great accuracy. So that's what the geodetic survey folks have done.
The Pandora's box is just this, though. We've already had two letters brought in here tonight from people we had, you know, the gentleman from Gilchrist. You know, two letters come in tonight of people that want to be in Alamance that aren't. You got on the Guilford County line a precedent. At that point, there'll be a precedent there. You've got Lake McIntosh straddling the line, and other people have developments that straddle the line. Where does it stop?
Well, that's a good question. I think that's a question the other 98 counties are going to be asking down in Raleigh. Yeah. Where does it stop?
The line's the line. And best challenge take place, Eddie. I'll tell you one thing. I've never seen anybody do the research.
That's the truth.
That guy has done.
He really has.
He's been
busy.
I admire him for it. But at a point, you have to make a decision and let the avenues that are out there for resolution, the courts, as in Mr. Childress's condition.
And he said you were going to ask for 1 point, then tell you the 3 points.
Do what? Yeah, if he can answer that tonight. I had asked earlier in the week that we, thank you for reminding me, I asked to be shown what points were on the geodetic survey that was in the original description of the survey, 1849, and I understand there's only, where is Bruce?
Right here.
Yeah, that there was, I think you told me today there was only three.
Yeah, and we have to ask them specifically, again, in Joan, what you did, once they established the line, they put new survey points that surveyors can tie into in accessible places. So I don't know for sure. I mean, they went through the process of the Cane Creek along three lines and the Hebron Church, some of those kinds of things. But when they establish a straight line, once they find all the positions, then they go forward from there and establish new points just along the line. So I'd have to call them back. I mean, they've given us this stuff before. We'd have to call and say which one specific doesn't match the original point. I think in general, they go through the survey, and I'm paraphrasing them, but they go through the surveys and all the stuff from that moment in time, and the combination creates the line, and then they put at convenient places in right-of-ways and stuff, those kinds of things, at Hebron Church and those kind of places where surveyors can actually access them and tie into them. That's where they put the modern points. So we'd have to double-check to see which one specifically again. I know it's been asked before, but I don't have that in front of me.
Madam Chair, can I read one thing from the NC Geodetic Survey?
Yes, sir.
I asked a question. Can you explain why the NC Geodetic Survey, lived in its belief, said refined their request for actual historic points they used? That's what we're talking about. 9 miles, 44 yards due west of Hillsburg, Walton Young, and asked that all that. And I asked him the question, why was the survey 9 miles, 44 yards, off 165 foot, 0.2 feet, using this numerical technology? And this is his reply as to why it was off, using this numerical technology. To be within 165 foot and the distance of 9 miles and 44 yards, 47,652 feet, is less than 0.4% error of the total distance, is significant for the time of the original survey. Resurveyed portions of the state line during the early years were found to have more than 3% error of the total distance of the survey. Now he's saying that it's okay for his equipment to be off, is what he's saying. What he actually said to me, and I'm willing to say it under oath in a court and move it to keep the line from having a bow in it. And I will testify to that in court.
Well, if that's the case, then why don't we give everybody along the line the choice of their county? I will support that. I will support every person along this line getting their support, getting their choice of county if they will pay for the survey.
Mr. Childers.
Well, I thought it was open up to public comments, Mr. Chairman.
But you need to ask for permission. I mean, you can have a public comment. Let's keep it.
I think what that letter's referring to is the old, he's referred to a numerical method. They use chains, actual chains, in a wagon drawn by mules, staking the ground, stretching iron chains. And that's not as accurate as a satellite technology. That's what he said.
Well, I want to look at this, and if, Mr. Harris, if you can accommodate me or anybody else that wants to go, that's fine. You're welcome to go.
I would love to go and take a ride with y'all.
We will.
I would love to take a ride.
Sure, can we have a van or something?
Can we borrow one of your vans?
It is safe. We're just picking it.
We will put this on for the next agenda, if that's okay. And in the meantime, we will do some. And what I'm hearing is, if we do accept what they're saying, then we can still ratify it to accommodate the other people. Is that right, Mr. Albright?
Yes, ma'am.
They just need to bring their survey in, and then we can ratify it after that fact. Because I wanted to make sure we can do that.
I want to be clear that not only this board, but the Orange Board has to agree with their survey as well.
Right.
And once the two boards agree the way the statute's written, then you go to Raleigh, present it to your delegation.
Right.
And Representative Engel, and I've already discussed it, and he said he would be willing, after both boards have reviewed a change, to present it to the legislature.
Okay.
And I think Representative Borson said the same thing, so I know there's two people back there.
As long as we can accommodate the people that, you know, if, because they're willing to do their own surveys. Most of them are, is what I'm hearing.
That's part of it. The other part is, as Mr. Sutton alluded to, you have to have a criteria for changing it. That's going to be applied statewide because you're asking the legislature to vote on.
Okay.
Linda, yes, what happened about the map that Mr. Benedict has drawn and showing where that it could go behind our property if we had it resurveyed and were willing to pay for it?
I'm not sure.
That's the option,
2B3. Yes, yeah, we still have that, but that's not what the geodetic people say. So I want to look at this.
Okay.
And then, and yes, sir. Now,
specifically with reference to the points that you were discussing right now, there is a pair of maps in your November 5th packet that Mr. Benedict from Orange County provided you with.
Okay.
It does include all of the three original locations as well as the additional locations that the NCGS provided.
Okay.
So if you have any questions, you should already have a copy of that. I have it in my own folder. If you have
in the booklet. I'm talking about in the booklet.
Yes.
In the booklet. Yeah,
yes.
I have that. But I still want, I had asked for this because I wanted to make, I want to see it, okay? So we'll just put this, if you don't mind putting it on the next reading. So I need a motion on that. Add it to it.
Just motion to table until the next meeting.
Okay. I'll make a motion that we do table.
Okay. All right, let's move along. No other comments? We're going
to move. Better vote on that. Dead motion.
Okay. All in favor, say aye. No opposed. Okay. Next is Sherry Hooks with the human resource, our human resources director. We're going to talk about the health care center contract.
Good evening, Madam Chair, members of the board. On November 2nd of this year, I came to the board and talked to you a little bit about a proposal that we have been working with ARMC on for a county employee health care center. And basically this would be a center that staffed 25 hours a week by a physician extender, 40 hours a week by an administrative support staff. And the advantage of the center is that with the limited number of patients, employees would be able to get in and out quickly, and it would decrease their time away from work. With no cost for the office visit, the hope is that the employees would be willing to go in and get medical attention quickly, and hopefully it would be before a condition turns into something more costly or more serious. We have received the contract from ARMC with the proposal for the health care center. The annual cost of the center would be between $157,000 and $172,000. The first year cost would include an additional $18,600. That's going to be for construction and setup fees. The contract is for a one-year period with an annual renewal option. As discussed at the November 2nd meeting, if we took 15% of last year's visits to primary care physicians, urgent care physicians, and emergency room visits that were not emergencies and diverted it to this health care center, that would yield $194,000 and would cover the cost of this center. The contract for the health care center is attached, and the insurance committee is seeking approval from the board to move forward with the center. If it is approved, we hope to have the center up and running February 1st of next year. And I'd like to answer any questions.
Let me ask you a question. Is it the retirees from the county, can they go to that same location?
What we're doing is we're wanting to include anyone that is part of our self-insured pool, so it would be available for retirees who are under age 65. Remember, those retirees 65 and over are part of our fully funded plan.
I had one direct question.
Okay.
Sherry. Number 11 there, it says we're going to designate an employee of Alamance County to coordinate this. Is that person in place, or what's the...
That would be the HR director.
That would be. Just curious.
Yeah.
That, you just should have wrote HR director there. Okay, so you've already designated yourself.
Right. Any more questions on this? I think it's a good idea.
I think it's a good idea, too.
Good for the county.
I surely do.
So do I hear a motion that
so
we
moved.
Accept this? I have a motion and a second. And everybody in favor?
Aye.
Okay, Sherry.
Thank you.
The next thing on our agenda is the sheriff's budget amendment for the jail.
You bet one thing, I'm not going to ask that county line to be moved. Every year, the state of North Carolina reimburses or gives us money from the state criminal alien assistance program. This year, we have $33,103, and it has to be used on something in the detention or involved in detention or removal of inmates across the state. Because of the backlog that the state system, prison system, is doing to us at the jail now, a lot of times we have 20, 25 they won't take. And then when they say they take them, we're having to send two and three vehicles. What we're wanting to do is purchase a Tahoe, which will carry six or seven inmates. And we want to use that money for it, which would be the $28,103, and that's fully equipped to haul inmates. The other part of the $33,000 is what we will owe the people that go in and pull from the clerk's office the number of criminal aliens that the state owes us money for. And that's where the $4,965.45 comes in. And I'm asking the commissioners to allow us to move the $4,965.45 to professional services, which allows us to pay the company that comes in and researches all the records to give us the amount of money the state owes. And the $28,000 has to be moved to capital outlay of vehicles, because a lot of our vehicles and transportation are way high miles, plus they can't take but two inmates at a time.
Any questions?
Yeah, have you seen a trend at all whether that money is increasing percentile or dropping as far as what they're paying us?
Well, I think it's certainly dropping, I think. And one of the reasons is that we are identifying a whole lot more that don't get through the system. For instance, you know, some agencies, a person may post a bond and never come to that jail to be checked. But when they go in and do the audit on the number of people gone through the court system that we've held or are gone through our court system, that's where that money comes from.
So, Jeff, could I ask a question?
Sure.
Was I hearing that the state was cutting back on paying this to the counties?
What the state said they'd do, any inmate we had to hold for backlog, they'd give us $18 a day. Well, that is absurd when it takes about $47 a day to house an inmate. So we met with our district court judge, and what was happening, a lot of these lawyers would come in for the judge and say, I got a client, this DWI judge, I know you're going to give him 60 days, but he's got a job during the week. You know, I want weekend, the sheriff hold him for weekends. Well, the judge would give him like 52 weekends in jail, and we were only getting $18 a day. So I went to the judges, and now they're saying $40 a day. And if you don't, guess what? You go to the big house. So okay. It was ridiculous. The state beats us up every chance they get.
You're right about that. Okay.
Well, they're trying now.
I know.
I'll make a motion.
Okay. I'll second. Okay. All in favor?
Aye. Thank you very much.
Next is the county manager reports.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. And following the road of the state continuing to beat us up, as you're aware, under General Statute 15-209, the county is responsible for all accommodations for all state probation offices as of January 1, 2010. This is part of the state shifting their fiscal responsibilities back to counties, very similar to what the sheriff mentioned. Currently, the state leases approximately 4,500 feet at the Hester Building on Maple Avenue in Burlington. By approving this agreement, we will be responsible for paying the lease payment of $5,657.30 monthly for the facility. This is $67,887 annually. However, once we find additional suitable office space, we do have the option to either put them in a county facility or another site.
Don't we have all these buildings that we've got? We let people stay in free. Can't we put them in there?
We are looking at, we also are paying rent in Graham for a probationary office, and that lease payment is approximately $50,000 a year. We've had discussions internally amongst staff that we could build something, we could totally renovate something, borrow the money, and use that $120-some thousand as our debt service. We didn't want to rush into anything in the short term. We just, you know, really got notification of this. It's our recommendation is to approve this for the short term, but we also need to work with probation as well to make sure that we meet their facilities, because any move as far as changing office space and floor plan has to be approved by state probation.
Okay, in short term on this lease, we're talking 5 years. Is that short term?
We can get out. We do have the 60-day option to get out.
60-day.
Without
penalty.
Okay. Any other discussion?
Well, I mean, do we need to give them a direction to look for that space? Or
I think
is that,
we do. I think we need to.
Is that what you're asking?
We've started to look right now. You know, it would be much cheaper for it to be in a county-owned facility.
And would it work under one roof?
Right. I think there's
15 probation
in Burlington, and I think there's 12 at the Graham facility, if I'm not mistaken. So it would be, you know, around 30 that we'd have to find office space for. But again, the debt service, you know, you can borrow money fairly cheaply now, and for debt service, about $120,000, it would be worth our.
Yeah, it would certainly be worth our while. Yeah,
yes, sir.
So continue that search if possible. Yeah.
And we have, I will be very honest, we just notified this in the last couple of months that this was coming up. We've kind of been focusing on our Group B projects. However, we can start putting more effort to this now as well. And we'll try to have you a recommendation fairly soon.
Sounds good to me.
A consensus that you just keep on.
Right, sure. But do need a motion to approve of approving the lease.
All right, I'll make that motion for the approval of the lease then.
I have a motion for to approve the lease. All in favor? All opposed?
Nay.
Okay.
I'm not going to vote to spend money we don't need to spend.
We asked 3-2, or was that?
3-2.
Okay.
How'd you vote?
Again.
I voted to do the lease that we get out of.
Okay, so
I voted against it.
You don't have a choice.
Yeah, I don't know that we have a choice there, do we?
No. Sure we do.
Four to
one. Yeah, well, sure we got a choice.
Greg, do we have a choice?
You do.
Well,
the vote's been had, so
we don't have probation officers.
I think the state would come back and probably sue us.
That's why we got an attorney. Yeah. That's why we got an attorney.
Well, it's four to one.
We would be breaking
one.
A general statute. Yeah.
It's 4-1.
Statute.
It's a 4-1,
David. 4-1.
Thank you. Okay. All righty. The next thing, introduction of the library.
Thank you, Madam Chair. We have today with Martha Sink. And Martha, if you would please stand. As you were aware, Judy Cobb will be retiring as library director as of January 1, with her last day being December 23rd. In the interim, I would like to introduce Martha Sink as our interim library director. Martha is currently the head of technical services and automation for the county and has worked for the county library services since 1996. We appreciate Martha and her willingness to step forward in this interim period. And taking this leadership role on. We did meet today with the librarians and Judy's management team to introduce Martha so that they were fully aware before the meeting. But we also do want to take this time to thank Judy for the job that she's done for the county, and we wish her well in her retirement. But we've been very lucky and very blessed to have her as our library director.
You surely have.
But I do want to introduce Martha. And you do have a copy of her resume in front of you. Very qualified, very smart lady, and we tried to talk her into applying for the job, but she said, you know, she was hoping for the interim job to be over by January 2nd. So it'd probably be longer than that, but we do appreciate her willingness and her experience. She'll do a wonderful job for us. So if anybody has any questions, Martha, do you want to say anything?
Somewhere in that pile, it's like.
Thank you so much.
I would challenge all the commissioners, but I won't embarrass anybody, but there's my library card.
I will say I ran into Commissioner Sutton in the library parking lot this afternoon.
I'm going to the library.
Somehow that don't surprise me.
My home away from home.
Number C.
Next, in your copy, in your packet was a copy of a proposed contract between county and Gerald Dorf to become our new tax administrator. A copy has been provided to you. Gerald is here tonight. We also appreciate Gerald's willingness to step forward during this time of transition and his willingness to take upon this leadership role. And he has interviewed with this board. This board has unanimously instructed, was a consensus board to have staff come up with a contract, and that contract is in front of you for final approval.
Stand up, Gerald, so people can see you. And blame it, you can start.
I would like to say, Mr. Hancock, and I appreciate the board giving me the opportunity to further serve citizens of the county. I'm an Alamance County native. I love the county. We're going to improve the tax office. Our employees are going to be held accountable for their actions or inactions. A great management team, and with their support, I think we can move forward and do a great job.
Thank you. So do I hear a motion that we accept this employment contract?
So moved.
And all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. No opposed. So here it.
Let me also mention, we will have a swearing-in ceremony beginning at 8:45 a.m. tomorrow morning in the tax department. We will have coffee and maybe a donut. But we'll officially swear Gerald in at that time, and we wanted to do that to give his staff the opportunity to be a part of the process and to support Gerald. So again, we do appreciate Gerald and his work.
Okay.
And I do have one other thing that you do have in front of you, and I do apologize for the lateness of this. We received this draft resolution at 5:30 today. At the request of our bond counsel, Gundars Aprons, we need to approve the following resolution that you have in front of you that will expand our request for funding allocation. And this is for the recovery zone bonds that we have requested. We have identified the entire county as a recovery zone district. We have $5.89 million allocated to the county. The city of Burlington has requested $2.89 million of that, leaving us a balance of $3 million. We do believe strongly that there's going to be a larger allocation of funds. It will be a much cheaper interest rate. You're saving about a 45% reduction in your interest costs. If we can get the full $6.5 million of capital improvement done through the bonds instead of doing a private placement. But in order to ask for the additional allocation, we have to approve this resolution by December 15th to request it.
Do you have any questions on this? Do I hear a motion that we accept this?
So moved.
Have second. A motion? Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay, next thing is our consent agenda. Does anybody want to put anything on that? If
ready
not,
accept.
Thank you. Have a motion to accept the consent agenda. And second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Anybody got any announcements? I would just like to thank you again for giving me this opportunity to be the chair of this board, because we do have a great county, and what I want to do is try, I can't please everybody, and this board can't please everybody, but we will certainly give it a try to do the best we can around this.
Thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur at 7 p.m. on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioners' website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the County Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel beginning at 10 o'clock p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching commissioner meetings online. For technical questions about this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of commissioner meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says Alamance County Commissioners to visit the commissioners' website, where you can learn about our commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting.